सामना करते।
गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड्स, आई ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ बियॉन्ड लॉ सीएलसी एंड शोभित यूनिवर्सिटी मेरठ वेलकम यू ऑल टू आवर पर्स्यूट। मिस्टर भारत, यू विल हैव टू चेक द नेटवर्क बैंडविड्थ एट योर एंड। इट्स शोइंग लो बैंडविड्थ। अनम्यूट।
Is it better now?
Now just check it. Yeah. In our pursuit to have webinars with speakers who can give the inputs to the effect which could help to, as they say, chisel out the things in the right perspective. And as those who have been connected with Beyond Law CLC, they know that we have been doing webinars on different perspectives, not only on law, but beyond law as the topic, as the theme and the topic, what we can say about ourselves as Beyond Law speaks of. Amongst us, we today have Mr. Bharat Chugh, a former civil judge and a metropolitan magistrate. As such, he does not need any introduction, probably as they say, during the cradle, you can imagine what type of child it could be. They imagined that we should keep his name as Bharat so that he could have his presence all over India, and that's Bharat. And I was just thinking, what would be the Bharat mean? It was said compassion and showing knowledge. I just Googled it around. So I thought that his compassion and passion towards law and decimating amongst to the remotest of the place, and that too during these times of virtual courts and virtual platforms, gives him a different perspective. He has been teaching in the academies and he's being followed by any persons. It is the only fair where one feels that being followed gives a heartening feeling that I am being followed by many people. Otherwise, being followed by one person also gives you some glitches in your thought process, your mind, your gait, anything. Mr. Chugh has been passionate not only of taking pro taking cases pro bono, but he has also been appointed as amicus curiae in a lot of cases. And as those who are not aware as such of amicus curiae, it's known as a friend of the court. So today he's not acting as a friend of the court, but I will say a step further. As they say, sometimes it's another arm of the from the armory. It says that he's not today acting as a friend of friends to give the insights of the topic of defense strategies in criminal cases. And the strategies to move forward is the only life to move forward. His topics, how to do crack the judicial examination, et cetera, et cetera, are some of the facets. I will say one of the colors of the seven colors of the rainbow. So whatever color you try to find, it will just give you a good show during even during the cloudy day of today. Over to you, Mr. Bharat.
Yeah. Thanks, Vikas, for that very generous introduction and setting the tone for the entire discussion. Absolute pleasure being here. I've seen your work lately, and you guys are doing a terrific job bringing together theory and practice and bringing about that synthesis, which is so important in the profession of law. I've always been very skeptical of the claim that theory and practice are two different things. I've always used theory and the first principles of law to succeed in court, and I've tried bringing in the practice of the court to the classroom in order to try and be a better educator. So theory and practice go really well together, and thank you so much for building this platform where we have some of the best minds in the country come and weigh in and discuss their strategies, their experiences on important areas of theory and practice. So thank you very much. I would start off by, you know, addressing one point. Is that's about the why should you pay attention to what I'm going to talk about? Why should you be worried about defense strategies? Why should you, you know, pay any attention to what I'm going to say? So as we criminal lawyers like to, you know, say that whenever somebody who comes in to address and claims to be somewhat of an expert at an area of law, you ask that person to establish his credibility and his competency to testify, as they say. So I know I make no claims to great insight. I make no claims to, you know, having figured it out all. We are all learning. We are learning every day. Age is definitely not on my side. But in the last 9 years of practice and being in the legal field, I've tried gaining some experiences and thoughts and from different perspectives. So I like to think of my life, you know, and I'll just spend 1 minute on it. I like to think of my life so far in law and my learnings as a football field or a game of football, where when I was preparing to be a judge and preparing to be a counsel, it was almost like sitting on the bench, waiting to be called into the game, you know, with your nose pressed against the glass. When I started off independently practicing for a year or two, it was like being a player in the game. When got the great opportunity of working as a judge at 23, it's like becoming a referee overnight from a player in the game, where you're setting out the broad rules of how a trial is to take place, how the game of justice system has to be played in accordance with law, calling out fouls, calling out rules of the game as a referee does or as a judge does. Then back again as a lawyer, have got the opportunity to work on some very interesting cases. And finally, so I've been on the sidelines, I've been a player, I've been a referee. And finally, now in my engagements with people, young lawyers, students, young judges, aspiring or otherwise, I've also got the great opportunity to sort of work as a coach as well, where I can pass on the little that I know about these things. So I hope that at least raises a rebuttable presumption of my ability to testify on this issue. And that having said, let's quickly cut to the chase on the strategies that you can adopt as young defense counsels in order to more effectively represent your client, in order to more effectively assist the court in the pursuit of truth, in order to better ensure a fair trial. So, you know, you can also see this as things that usually are not talked about in the law school. So we'll also take care of some of the more nuanced practical elements. So when I was preparing for this and Vikas reached out on what can be the defense strategies, I sort of went back, you know, a few hundred years on how we used to do criminal trials. And I love to do that because I believe the past is a great way of understanding the present and the future. And I was intrigued to find out the very, very bizarre ways in which justice dispensation used to happen back in the day. So for instance, if you have an accused who's been accused of stealing something, instead of having a full-blown trial where the judge decides on the basis of evidences, what they used to do, at least in some jurisdictions, was take the accused, tie his hands, tie his feet, throw him in a well. And if the poor chap sinks, the person is innocent. And if the person comes floating to the surface, then that person is innocent. And if he sinks, he's guilty. And why is that? They had this thought that, you know, divinity somehow has decided his guilt or no guilt. So if you sank to the bottom, the goddess of water has accepted you. Or if you floated to the surface, the goddess of water has rejected you and then you're guilty. So very unsophisticated as a bizarre system of deciding guilt and no guilt. And people like you and me, young defense lawyers, would not have any role to play in a system like this. So fortunately for us, we've moved past those systems. We moved to jury trials. And finally to the way we conduct criminal trials in India, which is much more sophisticated than how things were. I'm sure 500 years down the line, we would be thinking about the way we do criminal trial today as very unsophisticated, but we leave that for the future to say. As of now, this is one of the best systems that we know. We all understand that there are various stages of a criminal trial or a criminal justice system process. Broadly, these stages can be divided in terms of an investigation, an inquiry followed by a trial. So most cases start off with the investigation phase, then the complainant registers an FIR and the criminal law is set into motion. I'm not talking about complaint cases as of now, because there you do not start off with the stage of investigation and the complainant directly files a matter in the court of law and the court takes cognizance directly and proceeds with the matter. So in those cases, you may only have an inquiry and a trial unless the court seeks the assistance of the police. But in normal cases, the case would proceed in this fashion. You would have an investigation by the police, where the police would collect evidences to prove guilt or no guilt. And those evidences which are collected would be put before the court for the court to apply its judicial mind, which is in the nature of an inquiry, a threshold hearing, a preliminary hearing, you can call it. And after the inquiry is done, which usually is from the point of summoning of the accused or cognizance of the case till the framing of charge, once charges are framed and the court feels that the matter is good enough to be taken to trial and there is prima facie merit in the matter, then trial begins, where all those evidences which have been collected by the investigating officer are allowed to be proved and disproved. So broadly, this is the framework we'll be working with. I'll tell you some interventions that defense counsels can make on each of those stages in order to better represent the interests of their clients. So as I said earlier, you'll have to remember at all points possibly that every trial is a voyage of discovery and truth is the ultimate quest. Your job as a defense counsel is not only to be a mere mouthpiece of the client, officer of the court, and these things are important for you to build credibility as a lawyer in the longer run. Finally, you have to also believe in your client's narrative, in your client's case. And if you're not totally convinced about your client's narrative, you would not be able to do justice to the brief and to essentially convince a judge who's taught not to believe in you, you know, your side of the narrative. So very important for you to believe in your case. If you think you have some moral scruples about defending a certain individual and you think you do not have it in you to defend somebody who's confessed of a crime, and the crime may be an extremely ghastly crime, then you should understand that and quit at the very first stage, because a criminal trial, there are lives at stake. There is no possibility or an option for half measures. If you believe in your client's case, believe in your client's narrative and story, go ahead, devise a strategy and go ahead. And the last preliminary point that I'm going to make is that in the earlier times, if you talk to conventional criminal lawyers, and this was how it used to be a few decades back, a traditional thinking of a defense lawyer would be to allow the prosecution or the investigator to build up a case and not make any interventions. And there was a good reason for that sort of a thinking, because prosecution bears the primary burden of proving guilt. And that guilt has to be proved beyond a reasonable doubt, which is an extremely high standard of proof. And defense counsels traditionally thought that let the prosecution case stand and fall on its own legs. We are not required to make a lot of active interventions. But that ideology or that strategy is changing very quickly. In more and more cases, the accused is expected to take definite stands, definite pleas, definite defenses. In most of the white collar crime cases or cases under the special acts, you would have something known as a reverse onus, where the accused would be under an obligation to prove his innocence in a lot of ways, and the burden has shifted. Cases of strict liability, cases of terrorism-related offenses, NDPS, so on and so forth. Especially in those cases, you would be expected to make interventions, take definite stands, and not just leave it for the prosecution to stand or fall on its own. You would have a lot of thinking to do, and the earlier you start, the better it is. Also, procedure is your friend and your enemy, and that's a point that's important to be kept in mind. We've all heard the cliche that procedure is the handmaid of justice, but if you do not pay adequate attention to procedure as the defense counsel, your CRPC, your Evidence Act, then procedure can quickly become the handmaid of injustice as well. Procedure is your friend. Procedure is your biggest weapon in your criminal defense that you can use in order to not just create obstacles in the way of prosecution, but also ensure that your client gets a fair trial. There is fair play in the game. Your due process rights, your rights against self-incrimination, your right of complete disclosure, all of them are respected. So make procedure your friend and understand it really, really well. So with that preliminary comment, I'd quickly cut to the chase and start with the stage of investigation. What do you do when a brief comes to you? Of course, you first of all start with understanding the allegations. You get a copy of the FIR, you download it from the internet. If you do not get it on the internet, as it happens in some of the sensitive cases, you move an application before the court and get it. You have the decision of Youth Bar Association of India versus Union of India 2016, which I'll get a copy of the FIR, even in sensitive cases. Use that, get a copy, strategize, sit with your client a lot. If your client is in custody, meet the client at the police station. You have a right to meet him. Although you do not have a right to be with your client at the police station during interrogation throughout the period, but you definitely have a right to engage with him and try to understand his side of the story. Even if your client is in jail, please talk to your client, visit him at the jail. The jail manual allows you to do that. Why do I say this? I say this because nobody knows the case better than your client. And the insights that you would get from your client are very important. And sometimes time is of the essence. Your client would be able to tell you that, for instance, in a murder case, your client may be able to tell you that, I wasn't even in the state. I was in Bombay when the incident is alleged to have taken place at Delhi. And if you know that, you would be able to get evidence protected and to ensure that evidence is not destroyed. You would be able to reach out, get the CCTV which shows your client in Bombay, who has a great alibi in this case. You would be able to safeguard call detail records, which would show to the court that your client was not even in the state when the matter is alleged to have happened, and so on and so forth. So engage with your client quickly, preserve evidences, and do it as soon as you can. If your client is accused of a bailable offense, then it's very simple. You get bail at the police station level itself, be ready with your surety bonds, your bail bonds, and that's not very difficult. Problem arises though in cases of non-bailable offenses when you have to go to the court to ask for bail for your clients. And when you are arguing for bail for your client, prosecution would throw a lot of arguments at you in order to get bail denied. I would just give you a few pointers and stuff that you can readily use in order to meet those objections by the prosecution. For example, one of the favorite arguments of prosecutors everywhere is that the matter is a very serious matter. Gravity of the offense is such that you cannot release the person. Now, that is an objection that has been dealt with by courts. You can use the case of Sanjay Chandra, which was a 2G matter, and Mr. Chidambaram's case, which is a 2019 Supreme Court judgment, to argue that gravity may be one of the considerations for grant or non-grant of bail, but by no means is it the only consideration, and bail should be granted in appropriate cases, even if the allegations are serious. Because the rationale is the accused is entitled to presumption of innocence even at the stage of bail, at least in the IPC offenses. And that presumption cannot be turned on its head by denying bail only because of allegations are serious. Because all that a prosecution needs to do otherwise is to level a very, very serious allegation and get the bail denied on the ground of the allegations being grave. Use these two judgments to argue that gravity may be one of the considerations, but is not the sole consideration. The more important considerations are whether your client would tamper with the evidences, whether your client would run away from the country and the process of law. And if there is a lookout circular against your client, and if you deposit your passport, then the chances of you running away are in any event minimal. Argue on these points. Another reason why courts deny bail a lot of times is and so serious, and we would be sending a wrong message to the society if we release you on bail. Now, that again is right in the face of established precedent on bail. If you use the case of Feroz Khan versus State of Delhi, 2020 Delhi High Court, a great judgment by Justice Bambani. Justice Bambani in no uncertain terms says that courts are not there to send messages to the society. Courts are there to decide a bail application on settled principles. They just have to see if the presence of the accused can be ensured by putting certain conditions, and there is no risk that the accused would run away, and there is no material to suggest that the accused would tamper with the evidences and witnesses, then there is no reason for you to grant and bail just because you message to the society. Use that judgment. I'm getting a few comments on my screen saying the name of the judgment. So I'll be sharing this entire list of judgments with Vikas, and that may be accessed. The first few judgments that I mentioned were P. Chidambaram and Sanjay Chandra. The next one that I mentioned it was Feroz Khan versus State. Also look at the judgment in the case of Dr. Shivinder Mohan Singh versus ED. Again, a 2020 judgment where the court says that the nature of the offense or the nature of the allegations has a very limited role to play while deciding a bail application. Another favorite argument of prosecutors everywhere is that the accused is a man who has got five other cases against him, five other FIRs, deny him bail on that ground alone. Now, the response to that would be that indeed, when the court is deciding a bail application, the court is to look into the antecedents of the accused. No two views about that. But merely because there are other cases pending, other investigations pending, cannot by itself be a ground for denial of bail. For that, you have the Supreme Court judgment, a very recent judgment in the case of Prabhakar Tiwari versus State of UP. And the rationale is very, very clear. Just because there are other investigations pending, you cannot deny bail because in all those investigations, also the accused is entitled to the presumption of innocence. You cannot turn the presumption of innocence, which is one of the most important touchstones of our criminal justice system, by denying bail on the ground of merely some investigations being pending. So keep that judgment also handy at the stage of bail. In many of your cases, the prosecution or the investigator would try to pass on certain information to the judge in a sealed envelope in order to try and get your bail dismissed. This is happening in a lot of cases which are of a slightly sensitive nature. On that also, now you have the precedent in the form of P. Chidambaram versus ED, where the Supreme Court has came down very heavily on this practice. The practice of passing on information to the bench in sealed envelopes without giving a copy to the accused. And that practice is to be deprecated. The court says that you cannot resort to sealed envelopes at the mere drop of a hat as a matter of course, only in very, very exceptional cases that you can use a sealed envelope and not otherwise. So use that judgment if the prosecution is trying to, one-up you by giving information in sealed envelopes. And be ready with all these. Make a binder of these judgments, which are pro-accused bail judgments, and that's going to help you a lot. A lot of times you would find that the prosecution are trying to get the bail dismissed on the ground that the accused has not cooperated in the investigation. There also, cooperation in the investigation, courts have said repeatedly, does not mean that the accused should come and confess as the investigator wants him to. So just because the accused is not saying what the investigator wants him to say does not mean that the accused is being uncooperative, does not mean that the accused is stalling the investigation and does not deserve bail. So on this, please have a look at the judgment in the case of Santosh versus State of Maharashtra, 2017 Supreme Court, says very clearly that just because you are not confessing doesn't mean that you are not cooperating. So the next time the prosecution takes the argument that you are not cooperating in investigation, please tell the court or the prosecutor that I have a right to silence as an accused. There is nothing in law that can compel me to incriminate myself. I have the Article 20 guarantees. And if there are certain documents needed from me, I can provide them. But just because I'm not confessing does not mean I'm not cooperating with the investigation. When it cooperation in investigation, there's one more aspect that you should keep in mind, which according to me is extremely important, is provide all the evidences which are there in your client's favor to the investigating officer during the investigation. Don't think that you need to save up all of this for the stage of defense evidence. If you have, for example, a document that completely exculpates you, answers the charge of the prosecution, bring it to the notice of the IO at the earliest stage. And that would give the IO the necessary material to also file a closure report against you or to make a finding that the case is not made out. Now, practically, we've seen that IOs normally only collect incriminating facts and incriminating evidences, and they disregard exculpatory evidences some of the times. Although under the law, an investigator is not there to just incriminate. He's there to find out the truth and file his report before the court. If you have great exculpatory evidence, please bring it to the attention of the IO and do it while maintaining a paper trail. Now, this is very important. For example, you just hand over some documents to the investigating officer. That may not become a part of the record. So do it by way of a post. Obtain acknowledgements. If the IO is not giving you an acknowledgement or is not receptive to you, get the magistrate involved, get the magistrate to supervise the investigation. The Supreme Court judgment in Sakiri Vasu's case allows the magistrate to monitor the investigation. Demonstrate in your application how the investigation is a totally one-sided one and how these important documents are not being taken on record. I'll give you an example. I was doing a case recently where the allegation against my client was that my client went into the server of a company and deleted some data and copied some data. So the allegation was essentially of hacking, criminal breach of trust, so on and so forth. Now, as on the date of the alleged incident, my client had no access to the server. My client did not have a working username and password. And when I asked the client, what's your answer to the charge? My client tells me that 1 week before the incident, I had myself made a request to the company to disable my username and password. And there is no way in hell that I could have accessed the server with my username and password for the simple reason that as on that day, I did not have a username and password and it was all blocked. And what's more, he had an email correspondence with the administrator of the system substantiating this, where my client completely gives up his access. Now, that was a document that was a clincher in a lot of ways. It answered the charge totally. I could not have accessed the server with that username and password because I simply did not have it. We brought it to the attention of the investigating officer in order to arm him with the necessary evidence to close the case. And even if the investigating officer does not close the case or does not give it the requisite attention, the fact that you put it on the record would make your job a lot easier when you are arguing on the question of discharge, because the email or the document that you filed would then constitute a part of the record. So very important for you to put those things on record. It would help you at the stage of discharge. It would help you at the stage of cross-examination of prosecution witnesses, defense evidence, final arguments, so on and so forth. So do that, obtain acknowledgments. Be very, very careful when you are filing your bail application. And for a moment, I've come back to the topic because I think this is crucial. Sometimes in our enthusiasm as defense lawyers, we write a lot in our bail applications, disclose all our cards, take positions on facts. I think it's important for you to keep your bail applications minimal and minimalistic, because at that point, when the case is at the incipient stages of investigation, you do not have a complete awareness and you know, understanding of what the case is. So do not take controversial positions in your bail application. Try to only broadly talk about the probabilities of the case. If it's a false case, say it's a false case. I say this for a reason, because there have been cases where people have taken positions in their bail applications which are extremely difficult to get out of. For example, in a case where somebody is killed by your client and he was driving the car, if you take the position in your bail application that your client was indeed driving the car, but your client was not negligent, or your client was not rash, or your client did not have the knowledge that it might cause death. If you say that in your bail application, it would become extremely difficult for you to come to trial and take the defense that your client was not even driving the car in the first place, because you've already made concessions on facts. You made certain admissions. So please be wary of how much you write in your bail application. Try to keep it to the bare minimum for the very simple reason, if nothing else, that the court is not deciding the matter on merits when it's deciding your bail application. It's not a trial before a trial, and please understand that. Talking of bail, I would sort of make the last point. Please be aware of your right to default bail. Enough has been said about this in different webinars. Just make sure that on 60 or 90 days, as the case may be, you file your default bail. Now the 2017 decision of Rakesh Kumar Paul, State of Assam, also allows you to seek default bail on the basis of an oral request. Just be ready with your bail bonds. Default bail, for those who arrive late, very quickly is the bail that you get if the investigative agency does not file the police report in 60 or 90 days and your client has remained in custody. This is a disincentive on the police to quickly finish investigation and not prolong it, because if they do prolong it, your client becomes entitled to bail as a matter of right. Please be wary and use this as often. Especially the COVID times have given you a great opportunity to use 167 subsection 2 proviso, which is the section that gives you the right to default bail. Because in many of those cases, investigations have not been completed because of the lockdown, but people have remained in jail. So in those cases, there is a Supreme Court judgment as well. Use that to say if 60 or 90 days have expired, even if there was a lockdown, you are entitled to bail, and that is an automatic bail. So Rakesh Kumar Paul, as I said, is a good precedent. Please have a look at that. I would also make another point, which I think is sometimes disregarded. When your clients are being questioned by, for example, your client in investigation has not been arrested. Many a times your client would not be arrested, right? If your client is participating in the investigation and providing the necessary assistance, he may not be arrested at all. So in those cases, you will have to carefully handhold your client when your client is called by the investigators and asked questions. In a normal investigation, for example, for an IPC offense, if your client is an accused and his statement is being recorded, we all understand that the statement is not even worth the paper it is on because it is inadmissible in evidence. So those cases are fine. But in cases where, for example, a PMLA investigation, where what your client says or what a witness says during an investigation is also admissible in evidence, those are the cases where you'll have to be more careful about what your client says in the investigation. You would have to make your client understand that he should not get coerced or pressurized in taking certain positions or giving certain answers. If the client is not sure of the facts and circumstances, it is absolutely okay for your client to say that I'm not aware of this. And also important for you to, you know, tell your clients that if there is something which is documentary in nature or an old record and a question is put by the investigator, it is absolutely okay for your client to say that I would check my records and respond. You know, it has been seen that many accused, many witnesses, because of the whole dynamics of a police interrogation, the good and bad cop games that are played, the whole pressure of the situation, they end up saying a lot of things which may not be correct just because they are under a lot of pressure. So, you know, tell your clients to hold their nerves. It's okay for them to say that I would check in records and come back, I would give the necessary document. Also very important for clients not to volunteer too much and only stick to the questions asked and answer them truthfully. So this sort of an engagement is very important to ensure that your client is able to speak the truth in the right way. Also write to senior police officers if you think that the investigating officers in your case are not investigating in a fair, impartial, and objective manner. Bring it to the notice of the senior officers, create those paper trails. You would really find them useful later. Get the magistrate to intervene and monitor the investigation, as I said. Visit the place of occurrence. That's usually a great thing to do if you want to really understand the case really well. Visit the place of occurrence, see if you can find defense arguments from there, see if you can find good pieces of evidence from the spot which can help your client, because sometimes your client may simply be in custody. And if your client cannot really afford an investigator, you would have to do the job for him. Although in appropriate cases, I would really urge you, when you are trying to understand the case, don't feel afraid or feel shy of taking the help of investigators, crime scene reconstructors, especially in complex cases, who would come and help you understand the case better so that you can take more informed defenses in front of the trial court. So take help when it's needed. Very quickly, if you are refusing test identification parades for your client, for example, your client says that I do not want to participate in the test identification parade because my face has been shown to the witness either on the phone or in a press conference, for example, and this test identification parade is not worth anything, and he refuses, please ensure that you record the reasons for refusal. Otherwise, this may be taken against you at the time of trial. Another quick tip for investigative stages usually is whenever the court is extending remand for your client, oppose remand. At each point, say that there is no useful purpose that is going to be served by keeping your client behind the bars. Get the court at that point to also sign the case diary. So different high court rules permit that. And why do I say it's important for the magistrate to sign the case diary on each page when he or she is extending the remand? It's important because there are always chances of the investigating officer, making certain later additions to the case diary or tampering or fabricating it. So this preserves the record of the investigation as it is on a given day. Request the court to sign it for you. The High Court rules allow you to do that. Case diary broadly is something that the investigating officer uses to record the day-to-day progress of the investigation and comes to be very, very useful at the time of trial. So pay attention to that. I'll make just two more points which are relevant to the stage of investigation before moving on to inquiry and trial. As I was telling you earlier, that in most of the cases, the accused would not have the benefit of an investigative apparatus at his disposal. Now, the state has investigators, the state has forensic labs, the state has prosecutors, the state has legal experts. But sometimes all that your client would have is you. So you would have to double up as also an investigator in creating or, defenses and also finding out evidences which might support your client. I'll take a very small example, which is very, very important for cases. In all of the cases where your client's defense is that he was not even at the place of occurrence and therefore has been falsely implicated, in all those cases, try to secure your client's call detail records at the earliest opportunity. We all understand that as per the rules and guidelines, the call details are safeguarded or kept or retained only for a year, for example. And after that, they are obliterated. So in many a cases, by the time the matter goes to trial, you do not even have your call records to prove that you were not in Delhi, you were in Bombay when the case happened, so you could not have committed the offense. Your call details would disclose that what was your tower location at a given point of time. And for example, if your client was in Bombay and was making calls from there, the call detail records would show that your client's phone was in Bombay and calls were made on the given day. In some cases, it may be a great alibi. So try to get those evidences safeguarded. Now, how do you do that? If you tell the investigating officer to go and collect the call details, he would ask you to go take a hike. He possibly would not get into collection of exculpatory evidence at all. What do you do then? The company may not give it to you. The investigating officer is not interested in collecting that. What do you do in that case? So in all those cases, you seek the help of the police. You take the help of the court. I'm sorry. So there, please file an application under Section 91 of the CRPC before the trial court, asking for call detail records to be called from the company, the telephone company, and kept in the court in a sealed envelope so that tomorrow you can refer to them, and to ensure that this very crucial piece of evidence is not destroyed, is not obliterated. And time is of the essence. In most cases, you would have to do it very, very quickly and not wait till defense evidence, because by that time, these records would be destroyed and you would be deprived of a very crucial piece of evidence. Last but not the least, on investigation. Many a times your client would ask you that I've been falsely implicated. Why can't we go to the High Court and get the FIR quashed in the nature of a threshold challenge? Now there, I would ask you to get a little slow and proceed with circumspection and caution. Indeed, in appropriate cases, you can go to the High Court and seek a quashing of the FIR, and an FIR quashing throws out the case at the very outset. No proceedings remain after that. But a High Court would be inclined to quash the FIR and short circuit the investigation only in the most extreme cases of false implication. And only, we have the case of Bhajan Lal, State of Haryana, 92, by the Supreme Court, which is the locus classicus on FIR quashing and tells you in what cases can you go in for a quashing of the FIR. That case would tell you that only in those cases where after the FIR is taken at its face value and is accepted to be correct at the very outset, even then it does not disclose an offense. Even then it does not satisfy the ingredients of the offense. Only in those cases of patent illegality and no offense being made out would you go on to quash an FIR. Not in other cases. Wherever there is a disputed question of fact, the High Court would ask you to go back to the trial court and argue on discharge or contest the matter on trial. So please, you know, going for a FIR quashing is always a gamble. It's always a risk, because if the High Court does not intervene in your favor and dismisses your petition, there is always a chance of it somehow subconsciously, coloring the minds of the investigators or the court at initial stages. And those observations which are made in the order sometimes come back to haunt you before the trial court. So take that risk only in cases where on the face of it, offense is not made out. For example, a prosecution without sanction, you know, or for example, there is a legal infirmity. For example, somebody entitled to diplomatic immunity is being prosecuted. Now that can be quashed. For example, an FIR registered for a non-cognizable offense, that can be quashed. A case where your client is made an accused solely because your client is alleged to be a director of a company and the company committed the offense. Now, if you can demonstrate from the records of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs that your client resigned from directorship 5 years back and you have a certified copy of that resignation and acceptance, then you would have unimpeachable evidence to put before the High Court and say that, my lords, this is the evidence that I have. I was not even a director of the company on that date, and they have made me an accused solely in my capacity as a director. The case has no legs to stand on. In those exceptional cases, the High Court may intervene in your favor, but not as a matter of course. So please understand the jurisdiction of 482 court first, and then proceed on to making the decision to go or not to go in for a 482. As I said, broadly in terms of stages, every investigation is followed by some form of an inquiry where the court applies its judicial mind on the evidence collected during the investigation. Now, as soon as the charge sheet is filed, the court would summon you as an accused. It would provide you a copy of the charge sheet, the police report. Please read it very, very carefully, scrutinize it very carefully. We've done cases where the charge sheets have run into 25,000 pages, 50,000 pages. In those cases, get an e-copy of the charge sheet, make it, and these may be very, you know, practical tips where you get the charge sheet scanned and, you know, you can do a control F and try to find out keywords in order to quickly make your strategy. Because some of these charge sheets would be very, very voluminous, especially in cases of financial crimes and the bigger cases. So read the charge sheet very, very carefully. Have a proper defense strategy. If your client has an alibi, plead that. If your client, for example, did the offense under a mistake of fact, look at that. If your client did not have the mens rea, examine that and build on it. Look at the chapter on general exceptions in the IPC very, very carefully. If your client, for example, is somebody who's an ex-bureaucrat who's being prosecuted now for a decision that he took as a public servant. For instance, somebody, instead of going in for an auction of a natural resource, went in for termination. And the allegation now is that there is corruption. The accused has given the government contract to somebody that he knows and has not gone by an auction. In those cases, you can, you know, think of defenses such as nothing that made it incumbent on your client to go in for an auction. For example, if there is a product that the government wants to buy and tender for, is produced by only one manufacturer in the world. In those cases, there is no point of going in for an auctioning because you only have one supplier, and the decision to go and purchase that thing by the government by way of nomination can be justified. For example, the allegation against your client is that your client is a minister, and as a minister, he took certain services or benefits that he was not entitled to. You would have to go back to the service rules, the rules that govern ministers and cabinet ministers to see what your client's entitlement was. You would have to argue that there is no misconduct on the part of your client because your client has only taken what he's entitled to. The point that I'm trying to make is that considering your case, you should have a strategy ready, you know, right after you get the charge sheet, because you wouldn't have a lot of time, especially in time-bound trials. Discuss it freely. A number of legal defenses also are, you know, open to you for you to take against the summoning order, for example, for your client. For example, let me take the example of 188 of the IPC. Now, 188 of the IPC, as we all know, talks about a violation of the orders of a public servant. So many lockdown orders which are violated, people who are violating those orders are being prosecuted under 188 of the IPC. Now, it's clear in law that for a 188 IPC prosecution, which is disobedience of a public servant's order, in order for that prosecution to be kickstarted, it's important for the public servant whose order has been violated to make a complaint. This is not a case where the police can do an FIR under charge sheet. It has to come by way of a complaint by the public servant. So if in your case, in a 188 IPC, the investigator has filed a charge sheet, has not filed the complaint of the public servant, now that's a technical irregularity, illegality, take that objection. You can take the objections of limitation in criminal cases. Sometimes there is a misconception that limitation is something that's alien to criminal law. That's not the case. Please read 468 onwards of the CRPC, where there's a limitation on the court on taking cognizance in certain cases. Also think of other technical challenges. For example, I'm arguing a case in the Prevention of Corruption Act, where the entire case is based against my client on the basis of some intercepted telephone calls. It is a case of alleged bribery and demand of bribery and corruption. Now, the whole case is based on telephonic conversations. Now, how do you record a telephonic conversation? How do you intercept or tap a phone call? All of this is provided by the Telegraph Act and the Telegraph Rules. Now, as a defense counsel, you would have to punch holes in the procedure adopted. For instance, if the interception order passed by the government tapping your client's calls is totally bereft of reasoning, there are no reasons recorded why your client's phone should be intercepted, or the order has been passed by an officer of the government who was not empowered to pass the order. Maybe he's not senior enough. Or in your case, the phones have been tapped first and the interception order obtained later. Or in your case, the file does not show any application of mind and the interception order has been passed without any public need, without any public emergency. In all of those cases, you can challenge the interception order and try to get that struck off. Once the interception order goes, the very basis or the foundation of the prosecution case goes, and you would be able to argue an acquittal or a discharge for your client. Similarly, in a lot of cases, you need a sanction from the government before starting a case. So try looking at sanction too. If you can challenge sanction on the ground of non-application of mind, on the ground of irrelevant consideration, so on and so forth. Please keep these technical objections also in mind. Another practical advice that I would give you is that when you have a client who's got some difficulty in attending the court, try and obtain the orders for permanent exemption from appearance for your client as soon as possible. There are judgments that say that if an accused is represented by a lawyer and the lawyer is appearing regularly, the courts may be liberal in granting exemption to the accused. And you would be surprised to know how relieving it is for some defendants and accused who are made to come to the court every day and stand the whole day and wait for their matters to be taken up, leaving their families, their businesses, and everything. Especially when they're presumed to be innocent till their guilt is decided. So use permanent exemption for your client and at least give your client that comfort that the client is not required to appear on every day. You are there to represent your client. On important days, of course, your client is required to be in court when the charge is being framed, when a statement under 313 is recorded, so on and so forth. Use the judgment in Bhaskar Industries to argue for an exemption. It has to be granted liberally. Look that up. It's very useful. One thing that I would want to again bring it to your attention, that when the charge sheet is presented to you or given to you as the accused lawyer, go through it very carefully. If there are documents missing, please bring it to the attention of the court quickly. If there are some documents which are illegible, file an application, get better copies, because you need to understand the case really well. You need to get every document. Sometimes the investigating officer would not file in court certain pieces of evidence which are favorable to you as the accused. This is known as withholding of evidence. This is known as non-disclosure. There, in those cases, if the IO has not brought the entire evidence before the court, you can move an application before the court to request the court to provide you more documents which the IO has withheld. And there is a complete duty on the investigator and the prosecution to give the fullest disclosure to the defense counsel. It is a matter of fair trial. It is a matter of natural justice. The prosecution cannot cherry pick and only file in court incriminating evidences and totally withhold and conceal exculpations, which is in your favor. Please use the case of V.K. Shashi by the Supreme Court. It's a 2012 judgment. Use the case of Siddharth Vashisht, the famous Manu Sharma, Jessica Lal case, 2010 Supreme Court. Use the case of Gopal Krishnan versus State of Kerala, 2020 Supreme Court. All of those cases would help you to get the complete disclosure from the prosecution and the IO. You would recall, I gave you an example a little earlier of the case that I'm contesting currently, where my client was accused of hacking and deleting data worth millions and millions of dollars, where my client had told me that my client did not even have the access to the server on that data. So there is no question he would have deleted the data. In those cases, if I bring that email where my client has given up his access to the notice of the investigating officer, and I have an acknowledgement, and the investigating officer very conveniently conceals it and does not file it in the court, in those cases, you would be able to use the judgment in the case of Nitya Dharmananda versus Gopal, 2018 Supreme Court, to argue that investigating officer has concealed crucial material which was given to him during investigation, and that should be filed in court, and you should be given a copy, and you should be allowed to rely on it to argue for a discharge. And so use this judgment, a very good judgment of 2018. In this case, this judgment, you know, went against established precedent for a very long time, which said that at the initial stages of discharge, you as the accused can only argue on the basis of the material that the IO and the prosecution relies upon and nothing further. But this judgment gives you the ability to go a little more wider and also rely on material which is crucial to the case but has been withheld by the IO. So this gives you the right to have a slightly more expanded hearing at the time of discharge. All the practitioners would understand and agree with me that a discharge is very difficult to get, because the court normally would err on the side of framing charges and testing the matter at trial. If there is grave suspicion also, the court can take the matter to trial. The court is not required to be convinced absolutely of guilt to frame charges. Only a prima facie case is seen at the time of framing of charge. So we understand discharge is difficult to get. But usage of this judgment would allow you to sneak in at the hearing for discharge material that is favorable to you as well. So this gives you a slightly wider canvas to play with, and in appropriate cases, use documents which are favorable to you at the time of discharge, for the simple reason that why should your client be subjected to the rigmarole of an entire trial, especially in a country such as this, where trials go on for years and years, when he has something that he can. can show to the court, and that completely exculpates the prosecution and destroys it. So use this judgment well. In appropriate cases, you as the accused, if you are not satisfied with the investigation and you think that certain very crucial areas have been totally disregarded by the investigator in the investigation of the offense, then you can always ask the court to also pass orders for further investigation. Earlier, there was a huge misconception that further investigation is something that only the court can order, that only the police officer can request for, and the complainant can request for. But the air is clear on this now. Even the accused can ask for an order of further investigation. What do I mean by further investigation? A charge sheet was filed in the court, but it is an extremely one-sided charge sheet. The accused's defenses have not been assessed at all. In all of those cases, you need some more investigation because the investigation is faulty and is almost one-sided. In those cases, the court can order a further investigation. The court can say, look here, I'm not satisfied with what you've done. Please investigate these five aspects also, which you've turned a blind eye to. And the investigating officer would then file a supplementary charge sheet. So that can be done. You can do it acting for the accused. The judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court in Veenubhai Haribhai versus State of Gujarat 2019, a beautiful judgment by Justice Nariman, would help you canvas that argument. Please read that carefully. Use it to your advantage. It's a great defense strategy. You're talking about, you know, many of you must be doing cases under the Negotiable Instruments Act for check dishonor. In all of those cases, my only advice to you would be, and I've had the opportunity of heading a special court doing just 138 cases for some time, please ensure that your client's defense in a 138 case is consistent through the stages. Your client, we all understand in a check dishonor case, the client has to, or the accused has to respond to the legal notice. And without the legal notice, the check dishonor case cannot be filed. In those cases, please advise your client to reply to the legal notice, take a good defense, come to the court at the stage of, explanation of accusation, which is known as a notice framing under 251 of the CRPC. Advise your client to take up a very specific defense. In fact, the Delhi High Court judgment in the case of Rajesh Agarwal also obligates the accused to take a very, very specific defense at the time of framing of notice. And if the defense is not specific enough, the accused may not have the opportunity of cross-examining the complainant also in certain cases. So take a very good defense in reply to legal notice in a check dishonor case, even before the case is filed. If you have a defense, for example, that the check was given for a security, or the check was lost, or the check was stolen away, or your signatures are not there even on the check. In those cases, take that defense in reply to legal notice at the time of framing of notice, in your applications to the court, in your cross-examination of the complainant and witnesses, in your statement under 313 of the CRPC, in your defense evidence. Please maintain consistency in your defenses. That helps you build credibility before the court. Now, a few quick words on trial. And Vikas, please feel free to, you know, stop me if I'm overshooting my time. I belong to a species of lawyers who file a 1,000 page brief in the court and still call it a brief. So we have a tendency to sort of overshoot our time. Just let me know and give me a sign.
So at least we haven't touched even 100 right now.
Awesome. So I'll speak for a few minutes more. You know, we can also engage thereafter. On trial, please remember the rules of burden of proof. Very quickly, you know, if you are the counsel for the accused, some witnesses are being examined in chief. Do not think that you do not have a role in examination in chief. For example, eyewitnesses are deposing against your client. Please be very, very vigilant then. For example, the prosecutor is leading the witness in an examination in chief. And what do I mean by leading? The prosecutor is asking leading questions to the witness in an examination in chief. Please raise an objection. In examination in chief, the witness has to come to the court and tell the story as it happened. It is no job of for a prosecutor to lead the witness at the time of examination in chief, except in certain cases of introductory matters. You know, why do I say that the prosecutor should not be allowed to lead the witness at the time of examination in chief? The answer is simple. Because if the prosecutor leads the witness, he gets out of the witness's mouth what he needs to get out, and which may not be really the true and complete truth. So make objections. Take objections that the witness is speaking something that is not in the knowledge of the witness. Take the objection of hearsay. Take the objections of irrelevancy. Take the objections that what the witness is saying in the witness box is privileged communication and cannot be admissible. Take the objection that the witness is filing a printout but has not complied with 65B of the Evidence Act. We all understand how important 65B is in today's day and time. And no electronic record is admissible in a court of law without compliance with the conditions of Section 65B of the Evidence Act. But you as the counsel would have to take the objection then and there. If a printout has come on record without a certificate, please raise that objection. I'll tell you the risk. If you do not take that objection then and there, then it is taken to have been waived. You are taken to have let go of your right. So please be vigilant. You know, we had the decision of Arjun Pandit Rao recently on 65B. Read that. It's a huge different session altogether. Please be vigilant on raising objections would be my tip to you. Cross-examination, very quickly. Again, cross-examination, something that I've been really passionate about in terms of engagement. You know, it can be a whole semester course, but if I could just tell you a few of my thoughts on the little that I know about it, would be, it's all about preparation. Failing to prepare is preparing to fail, as somebody said. You know, when I've cross-examined in some of my cases, I've lived those cases. I've, attached or affixed the depositions on my cabin, on my bedroom door, everywhere, and in the car. And I would be practically living the case before examine, because you'll have to remember that when you're cross-examining, you do not know where the witness can take you. The possibilities are endless. And you have to be prepared on facts. You have to be prepared on all the things that the witness can tell you in cross-examination. And please be very, very clear on the facts. You were not even there when the incident happened. The witness would have been there, and you have to falsify him on something that you do not have a first-hand knowledge of. So prepare a lot. Whenever in doubt on whether to ask a question or not ask a question, please don't ask the question. You know, more cases are lost on having asked a question in cross-examination than not asking it. You know, I used to ask my dad, what are the best questions in a cross-examination? And my dad used to say, tongue-in-cheek, that the best questions in a cross-examination are questions not asked. Please be very careful on what you ask. Please only ask leading questions. Questions which have yes or no answers. And never ask journalistic sort of questions. What do I mean by that? Don't ask the witness questions such as what, why, how, where. This gives a lot of opportunity for the witness to spin a yarn and, you know, take the narrative away from you. So please keep your questions short and plain and leading questions. Keep the witness on a tight leash. Never ask a question the answer to which you do not know yourself as a counsel. Because if the witness takes you to territory that you do not know about, that's going to be a huge problem. And don't ask, for God's sake, the ultimate question. Sometimes when you're on a winning streak in a cross-examination, you get really tempted to ask the ultimate question. What do I mean by that? Let me just, you know, give you an example. And this is anecdotish. So there was a guy, a lawyer, who was defending his client. The allegation against his client that his client in a boxing match had bitten off the ear, as ghastly as it sounds, had bitten off the ear of his opponent in the middle of a fight or a practice session. So that was the allegation. The counsel asked the question to the witness, did you see my client biting off the ear of the opposite side? And the witness said, no. And that, according to me, is where the counsel should have stopped. Because the witness has successfully said, or effectively said, that he did not see the accused biting off the ear of the opponent. And the counsel should have stopped there. But the counsel, in enthusiasm, got a bit more enthusiastic and ended up saying, then how do you come and testify before the court? Now that was a disaster, because then the witness went on to say that I may have not seen your client biting off the ear of the opponent, but I saw him spitting it out after he had eaten it. So, you know, in that case, just by becoming a little greedy, just by becoming, not knowing when to stop, the whole case was given up. So be clear on what you want to achieve. Once you've achieved it in your cross-examination, exit with grace. Do not spend too much time, because the witness would then sort of take you, on a different ride altogether. Also stop. When you're cross-examining, you should be absolutely the master of the proceedings, where you are keeping the witness on what you are asking him. Many witnesses would have the tendency to spin yarns, to answer your question in yes or no, and then go on to dictate an answer that runs into 3 pages, which is what we know as volunteering. The witness volunteers. He answers your question, then goes on to, write almost an essay on the topic. That's very dangerous, because then you have to unravel each of the strands that the witness has volunteered about and cross-examine on all of those aspects. So there you would be perfectly entitled to tell the court that the witness is being very, very verbose. My question is a very simple one with a yes and no answer. He should answer that. He has said what he wanted to in the examination in chief. Let him not convert my cross-examination in an examination in chief. If the witness wants to clarify something and the prosecutor is inclined to, let re-examination be done. Cross-examination is not the time when you volunteer and talk about all and sundry things. Another aspect that to me is important, and this would be the last, two or three things that I say, is for you to understand and pay a lot of attention to the psychological aspects of a cross-examination. What do I mean by that? Cross-examination is nothing but clever questioning, where you are supposed to contend with a witness and truth is supposed to come out of it. But it's very important how you structure your question if you want to get the desired answer. I must strongly recommend to you the study of Loftus and Palmer, who have examined, a very interesting proposition as to how what answer does a witness give can be dependent on how you frame the question. If you frame a question in a certain way, you can get the desired response. And since it is better to, show you instead of telling you, let me give you what they did when they did the study. A lot of people in that study, and it was a controlled study, were given a video to watch, like the test subjects. They were given a video to watch. The video was about a car accident. After they saw the video, all the witnesses, and they all saw the same video, by the way. When they saw the video, all of them were asked questions, and separate questions for separate witnesses. For example, some witnesses were asked the question, please tell me, Mr. Witness, how fast were the cars going when they smashed into each other? Straight enough question. Another set of witnesses who saw the same video, by the way, were asked the question about how fast were the cars going when they bumped into each other. And the third set of people were asked the question, how fast were the cars going, according to you, Mr. Witness, when they contacted each other? Same video, same car accident, different ways of asking the question. One set of people are asked, how fast were the cars when they smashed into each other? Now, smash is a very strong word. Second set, how fast were the cars when they bumped into each other? A very softer word. Third set of people, how fast were the cars when they contacted each other? The most mild. Now, the people who were asked the question with smash in it said that the speed of the car must be 40 miles per hour. The people who were asked the question, how fast were the cars when they contacted each other, said that the speed of the car was 30 miles per hour. Imagine the difference of 10 miles per hour in the eyewitness testimony, so-called, just because you asked the question differently. Same witness, different witnesses looking at the same video, but perceiving different things, remembering different things on the basis of how you've crafted the question. So please pay attention to what you say. As a lawyer, your words are your stock in trade. please be careful on how you say things. Please know your witness really well. Where does your witness come from? Is he a stock witness? Who is the police's favorite witness and has deposed for 15 police cases in the past? Know that about the background of your witness and destroy the witness in the court. Not literally, of course, but by impeaching the witness's credibility. If the witness is a forgetful witness who on every question of yours is saying, I don't remember. This is a witness that I call a witness who has selective amnesia. This witness would remember everything that goes on to support this witness, but would conveniently forget things that are not favorable to the witness. How do you handle such a witness? Because if on every question the witness is telling you, I don't remember. So on those cases, you would have to, by clever questioning, establish that the witness's memory is perfectly intact, but the witness is conveniently not answering the questions because the answers would be unfavorable to the witness. How do you do that? By asking questions initially in your cross-examination of very, very old things which the witness remembers because it is self-serving. Ask the witness, 10 years back, you won this award. This is how you did it. This is how you won. This is how you performed really well. And the witness is going to answer all of that. That is going to establish that there is nothing wrong with the witness's memory. And then when you start asking him the difficult questions later, he would not be able to tell the court that I don't remember. And even if he does tell the court that I do not remember, the court may not believe him. My last bit on cross-examination is, if you are cross-examining multiple witnesses, please strategically take that decision. For example, if your client is accused of murder, there are two eyewitnesses, both of whom claim to have seen the incident, and both of them happen to be brothers, real brothers staying in the same house. In those cases, my advice to you would be, please cross-examine both those witnesses on the same day, one after the other, because if you cross-examine one eyewitness on one date and then cross-examine the next witness 3 months down the line, when the case is adjourned, the witness who is the second eyewitness and the brother of the first eyewitness would come, you know, much wiser, because he would have the benefit of seeing his brother's cross-examination on the same lines. In those cases, please request the court that, you know, you get the examination in chief of all these witnesses recorded at one go. I would cross them at one go right after one another on one day. It's a perfectly justified request. Courts allow that as well. Please take the case of Vijay Kumar versus State, 2017, Delhi High Court, a brilliant judgment by Justice Gauba, which allows you to be the master of the order of examination of witnesses. Please keep that in mind. Keep in mind the importance of re-examination. If anything your witness has said which is damaging or misleading, please use re-examination well. I call it putting Humpty Dumpty back together again, where in a re-examination, you get the opportunity to rebuild the credibility of a witness. So please work on that. In many a cases, your witness would be so flustered by your cross-examination that the witness would, you know, sometimes keep going out of the room, keep looking at his phone, keep looking at his hand. You know, I had a witness personally who after 4 hours of examination, keep going out for the loo and, you know, spending extended times outside. And I got that demeanor of the witness recorded. There was a witness who kept looking at his hand for clues. You know, apparently he had scribbled some notes on his hand while he was being cross-examined. I picked that and requested the honorable judge to record it as a demeanor of the witness, the conduct of the witness on the file. And that was recorded, which is of great significance when the court is appreciating the evidence. Because you would have to remember the witness is deposing today. And the matter may be decided, you know, 1 year later, possibly by a different judge. So if a witness has been extremely nervous, if a witness has tried to cheat on his cross-examination, or the witness in the middle of cross-examination gets flustered and leaves the room, all of these things should be recorded on the file in the deposition. These are known as remarks on the demeanor. Please have them recorded. I can go on and on about cross-examination, but I'll stop right there. I would just leave you with the thought that after the prosecution evidence is over, please use your examination under 313 of the CRPC as an opportunity to explain your case. This is your chance where your client would get into a direct dialogue with the court, and it would be an opportunity for you to explain all the incriminating circumstances. Don't go in for personal responses of the case against me is false, matter of record, it is wrong. No, give specific responses. The court is going to hold your case to be much more credible if you specifically grab the bull by the horns and give specific responses. Don't be shy of taking the stand as an accused. An accused is a competent witness. I would agree that in most cases, if the prosecution is not able to measure up and prove the case beyond all reasonable doubt, there is no reason for you to enter the witness box because the onus never got shifted on you. But my friend, on all those cases where the onus is on you to prove your innocence, like some of the cases under the NDPS Act or the PMLA, or for example, a dowry death case where there is a presumption against the husband if the wife has died within 7 years of marriage and an unnatural death, and there has been some cruelty for dowry. In those cases, it is the accused burden to prove innocence. So in those cases, please don't be shy of entering the defense box. That has a huge impact. That has a huge bearing on the case. Don't be shy in cases. Of course, it would depend on what your case is when you take the decision. It's an important strategic call. Make that call well. And finally, on arguments, I would advise you, that when you are arguing the case, your moral compass and the judge's moral compass should be aligned. The judge should be able to trust you in final arguments. Please concede bad facts. If you have very, very bad facts against you, please concede them at the very outset. Take it on the chin and say, my lords, I understand that this has come before me, but let me tell you, this is how it should be read. Please allow me to interpret it. Never run away from facts, because the opposite side is going to definitely allude to those facts against you. If you take them yourself, you refer to them, you take the sting out of it, and court is also, reasonably assured in your reputation and independence as a lawyer if you concede bad facts. Do not fight everything. Choose your battles carefully. Concede bad facts. Argue really well. Argue really well on sentence also if unfortunately your client stands convicted. Point out the mitigating circumstances. Explore concurrent running of sentences. Try to seek the benefit of probation. Some of these interventions would help you more effectively represent your clients. Please keep in mind these points and the procedural safeguards. As I love to say, what distinguishes a criminal justice system from a criminal system is procedure and these safeguards. Please keep them in mind, and this would allow you to help the court find out the truth better. Thank you very much for this opportunity, Vikas. Over to you.
Thank you. The brief was actually brief. It was not the way you projected, firstly. And secondly, the way, and I'm just reminded that in the childhood, we have said that the jigsaws of puzzles and the Rubik cube are to be settled with a strategic thought process. That is the way you taught us what the strategies could be. And taking things for moving forward, and once you said that you started off with the football match, I'm reminded, I was just watching on the YouTube, some motivational speaker was speaking that why football match, cricket match, etc., too happy and to be cheered about. He said that it gives you a lesson to the life that 11 players are back of you to ensure that you are out and to ensure that you do not score a goal. And once you achieve, that is where the entire participants or spectators actually get cheered about. So the moral of the story was that invariably you have to think a lot. If you have to succeed in life, at least 11 people are behind you to ensure that you will be pulled down. And if you score your score, that is the way to move forward. And the way you have put it across the things, that's fantastic. We will take the questions.
Sure.
I would request, friends, that instead of thanking Mr. Bharat, I will, under the deeming fiction of law, I will take the power of attorney to ultimately thank Bharat, because in that process, what will happen is that the question and answers will get intermingled, and we will be running. We are running short of time as such because we don't take webinars to the extended draw. This is, please, police, do not file documents with the charge sheets collected during the investigation. What should be the remedy as an IO did not give acknowledgement for the same, but having recording of call proving documents were handed over?
Great question. I would ask you to, you know, go through Nitya Dharmananda now. If the document has not been made part of the police report and it really helps you in the defense, then you can file a Section 91 application also at the stage of charge and get that document on record and use it to argue for discharge. This was not the position since till 2018. The Supreme Court in Debendranath Padi earlier, which was a large bench decision, I think at least three judges, had said that at the stage of charge, only the charge sheet can be looked at. But a carve-out has been made by Nitya Dharmananda now, which allows you to bring that document also on record by filing a 91. Show the court your acknowledgement that you've really given these documents to the IO, and the court can pass directions to the IO, bringing these on record and giving you that opportunity.
This is... My query is, P. Chidambaram's case is related to a socio-economic offense. Will it also work in serious offenses of IPC, for example, Section 302 or Section 304B charge?
That's a great question. So even in a murder case, if you look at, for example, 437 of the CRPC, which is the magistrate's power to grant bail, in those cases, there are implicit embargoes on the magistrate's power to grant bail in the case of an offense punishable with death or life imprisonment. So there is, a higher bar or threshold for getting bail on those cases. Invariably, those bails are granted by the Sessions Court or the High Court in 439 of the CRPC and not 437, although there is no bar. These cases can certainly help you in 302 and other cases also. Because even if it's a murder case, the fact of the matter is that the accused is presumed to be innocent until guilt is proved. Even in a murder case, there is no reverse onus or presumption of guilt. It would depend on what the facts in your case are. For example, if it's a multiple murder case of various young people and children, like the Natari case, it would be very difficult for the court to sort of grant bail in that case at the initial stages. But broadly, if you ask me, whether the proposition that gravity of the crime or the seriousness of the crime is only one of the considerations in grant of bail and not the sole consideration, does that principle hold true for offenses across the board, 302 included or not? The answer is yes. It is okay for you to take the argument of P. Chidambaram and Sanjay Chandra even in those cases.
This is by Praveen Kumar. Quashing of charge sheet dismissed by High Court. But in order it is mentioned, grounds can be taken at the charge framing, at the time of framing of charge. So is it possible to file a discharge application at this stage?
Absolutely.
Okay. This is a further investigation application should be filed before the magistrate. Please discuss how postmortem, sir, your views on Dr. Kafil case when he was given bail, but the police imposed draconian law of NSA and he's still in jail. We will not take the views. We will just take the questions. Because we have to segregate. That is what Bharat told us. You have to separate the wheat from the chaff, or you have to find the needle from the haystack. Can we discuss, he's just giving an example in Sushant murder case, how post-mortem can be overruled and other cover-ups?
That's a great question. If in a given case you think that the post-mortem is not entirely correct and is a cover-up or leaves a lot to be desired, please feel free to invoke the trial court under 156.3 and tell the court that these are the reasons that the postmortem is not credible and the court should monitor the investigation. And if the court is monitoring the investigation, it is empowered to pass directions for, a re-examination, a fresh view on the medical injuries and all of that. And not just a 156(3). Even the High Court exercising writ jurisdiction can pass certain orders, you know, in the powers of 226, 227, 482, so on and so forth, to instruct the police or the investigators to conduct postmortems properly or to get another fresh view if you think the first one is not credible. So all those options are available to the victim's family as well as the accused in the given case. And we are not talking about any specific cases. I just try to highlight the broad proposition of what I think.
This is the Ankit Dwivedi. What is the remedy if there is no MLC in a rape case and a complaint is lodged after an year of the alleged incident?
Am I audible, Vikas? I just lost you for a moment.
No, both. Audible as well as visible.
Perfect. So if you could just repeat the question, what I heard was that
what is the remedy? No, this is by Ankit Dwivedi. What is the remedy if there is no MLC in a rape case and a complaint is lodged after an year of the alleged offense?
So that obviously as a defense counsel gives you a lot to argue on. It's not necessary in all sexual assault cases that there would be MLCs and there would be injuries. For example, cases where there is a misconception of fact. For example, cases of false promise of marriage, for example, or a deceitful promise of marriage and sexual assault or sexual relations, under that promise. In all those cases, the MLCs are, they take a back seat. So it would depend on what is the case before you. If it is a case of a forcible sexual assault, the MLC, of course, is extremely important to show the nature of injuries, extent of injuries, resistance, if any, so on and so forth. So if it is that case and there is no MLC, you have a lot to argue on. If it is a case of, again, an incident that happened 1 year back and it was a case of consent of the lady obtained under misconception of fact, for example, then the MLC not being there may not be as important. If the sexual relations otherwise have been established by other evidences and corroborated by other things, then MLC would take a back seat. So you'll have to devise your strategy according to the facts of your case.
This is a question. How medical negligence in a corona quarantine center is charged to whom it is reported can directly give a complaint at the police station?
Great question of great contemporary significance. I'm afraid that the police cannot really register an F under 304A, for example, death by rash and negligent act, or 337 and so on and so forth, which are usually invoked where injuries or death has been caused because of rash and negligent act of the doctor. In all those cases, there is an embargo on the police not to register the FIR directly. I think the case of Lalita Kumari by the Supreme Court says that in cases of medical negligence allegations, there has to be a preliminary inquiry by the investigating officer before the FIR is registered. And the investigating officer is obligated to take the opinion of medical experts and medical boards to ensure that this is indeed a case of medical negligence or not. And that assessment has to be done. The court had done it to ensure that doctors and people in healthcare are not prosecuted at the drop of a hat. But it has practically made registration of these cases very, very difficult. Apart from your criminal remedies, of course, you would have the remedies to go to the regulator of the health sector, the medical council, so on and so forth, to address your grievances.
This is by Sameer Goyal. How a council can calculate whether an anticipatory bail or a regular bail is required, where the IPC sections are though non-bailable offences, though as per Supreme Court judgments, bail should be given when offence is below 7 years. And even IO is not interested in arresting the accused.
Great thoughts. You have combined a couple of thoughts in one question. Let me try to unpack it a bit. You are absolutely right. It's a strategic decision whether to go in for bail or not. Sometimes going in for a bail or an anticipatory bail is, aa bail mujhe maar in a lot of ways. And, it's a double-edged sword. Because sometimes you may not even be an accused per se, but you have a threat of being arrested. The investigating officer is calling you. You do not know whether the investigating officer is calling you to only ask you questions or make that arrest. So you would have to, make that assessment in a given case. But let me give you this working formula. if the offense is punishable with less than 7 years, then Arnesh Kumar has in any event restricted the powers of the police officer to make an arrest where they have to record reasons and, you know, so arrest is slightly more difficult in offenses in less than 7 years. But if it is more than 7 years and it's non-bailable and you have a apprehension of arrest, it is always good to err on the side of caution and get an anticipatory bail. Anticipatory bail would ensure that as soon as you get arrested, you would be released on furnishing bail bonds. So an anticipatory bail is a protection not from arrest, but from custody. Regular bail, as we know, is only after your client has already been arrested and now you want him released from detention. I think that sufficiently addresses your broad points.
This is by Khushbu Pawa. What are the importance of medical evidence under Section 302 at the time of session trials?
Very, very important. I mean, 302 largely is a case that's based on medical evidence. You as a defense counsel would be expected to, you know some parts of this, expert science and area better than the doctors you would be cross-examining. It's cases are won. 302 cases are won and lost on medical legal evidence. Please study this very carefully. And my advice to you would be, in all the cases where the client can afford it, get an expert on your side too, who would help you cross-examine, who would help you understand, who can also depose as your expert to counter the government expert. So keep that in mind.
Can further investigation be a mode of harassing the system in a way, and should it be used in a rare case? Kindly elaborate, since it's a gray area.
This is great question. Great question. I agree. It's a gray area. The parameters on when it should be exercised have not been laid out with clarity, unfortunately. I can tell you from experience, the cases in which courts have exercised such powers are, for example, important forensic material that is readily available has not been seized and has not been sent to CFSL. That would be a case of clear lapse in investigation, and the court would instruct the investigators to take care of that. Very important witnesses not examined, very important evidence being available in a different jurisdiction, but the investigator has not sent a request to a different country asking for those evidences, which is known as a letters rogatory, completely disregarded the international, aspect and availability of evidence in another country. The court can ask him to further investigate, get material from a different country and file a supplementary charge sheet. So those are the cases of clear lapses where the court will. I completely agree with your premise that since investigation is essentially the domain of the executive, the investigator should be allowed to investigate in the way that the investigator deems fit. But again, no power is absolute. If the investigation is one-sided and partial and arbitrary, the judge is not a mere recording machine and would have to come in and pass carefully tailored orders on what aspects it is insufficient and what can be done to make it better.
So questions are pouring in. We will take just two last questions. This is, what when after the FIR, police is not working and submitting documents or case to the magistrate? What should be the further step?
That's a great question again. Many cases, they registered the FIR, but for years and years, police report will not be filed. What do you do? In those cases, I've personally dealt with some of those. File a 156-3 before the magistrate. Magistrate would straight away seek an action taken report or a status report or a reply from the police in most of the cases. That works as good indirect pressure on the police to conclude investigation and file a closure report or a charge sheet, as the case may be. So use that well, use writ proceedings, write to senior officers. All of this would help you get the desired result.
This is by Naveen. During cross-examination of a PW, it is established at least prima facie that an offense was committed by a relative of PW. Based on that cross-examination of PW and having facts in this case itself, which was suppressed by the witness in the earlier statement of police, can an FIR be registered against the person at this stage, or we need for the case to get over in favor of the accused? The police would invariably refuse registration of the case, saying that the case is pending in the trial court.
Great question. In this case, if PW has deposed against his relative number one, that person may be summoned by the court in exercise of 319 of the CRPC as an additional accused, but that's separate. To answer your question straight away, if the person has perjured himself on oath, if the person has perjured himself and given false testimony, that's usually a case. Do not get an FIR, but you get the court either to summarily punish that perjury. You would find this power somewhere around section 345 onwards of the CRPC, where the very court before whom the false statement has been made can summarily punish the perjurer. Alternatively, the trial court before whom the false statement has been given can itself become the complainant and file a complaint before another court for the case of perjury. Because in a perjury case, cognizance cannot be taken unless the court files a complaint before whom the perjury was done. So that is something you would get from a combined reading of 191 onwards of the IPC, 195 of the CRPC, and so on and so forth. Vikas, I think you're on mute.
Sometimes they say that the power of silence is much better than the words. As you said, that it's not always important. And they say silence is better than speech sometimes. So the questions will, as I said, continue to pour in. But I'm just reminded, like you said, that the two friends, two brothers are there and how their cross-examination should be done. I'm just reminded that one of the common message going upon in the WhatsApp group was that four students just took a bunk and they said that the car had punctured. So they were all made to sit separately and told that which tire had punctured, you have to write in that. Mr. Bharat, it was quite an insightful session, and the way the questions are pouring in, people are expecting on the WhatsApp also, they're saying that Mr. Bharat should be brought back again. I'm just reminded that when Manoj Kumar used to make movies with the name of Bharat, people just lashed up time and again going to the theaters. And that's probably the commonality between you and Mr. Manoj Kumar's movies, which were hit on being Bharat. So I can only say, come again, that becomes, that will give more insights to the another insightful session. And everyone, as I said, that I will be an attorney holder on behalf of having taken on virtual platform. I, on behalf of not only CLC, but all those participants who are on the platform as well as on the Facebook, thank Mr. Bharat to having given us insights to a topic which invariably is touching to all those persons connected with law and the common man. The at least Columbus found Bharat, we found Bharat on the virtual platform. And that's the very part for the day. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having me. Pleasure being here.